Yes. He has on some more new shoes. He's been shoe shopping.
Hey. Right? Hey, three pair the same, just different colors, brother. Come on.
That's surprising.
So, standing 6'1", he's obviously been in the gym working out.
Oh.
Because we can see the gun show going on.
Know this.
205 pounds from the windy city of Chi-Town, Mr. Johnny Fosco.
John Fosco does not take responsibility, nor can he be held liable for anything he says, does, or gestures. He's mentally healthy most of the time. If you are offended by these statements, know that it is not John's intention, but he doesn't really care. This being said, listening at your own risk, shut the fuck up.
Oh, I am feeling good today. Maurice Claret. I'm going to hire you, man. You're too expensive. Anyways, so today we are on... Okay. You guys cannot laugh about this because this is serious. It may not sound serious, but... As I navigate, no. As I navigate my way through this program through this world,
yes,
you will understand. Okay, so this program or this part of my world is called MYD. Okay, that stands for manage your dick. Okay, when I say, listen to me right now. When I say manage,
so appropriate.
No. When I say manage your dick, or we could call it manage your genitalia. Okay, this is what I mean. Everybody who listens to this show is listening so they can either build their own business, they can accelerate in the corporate world. And what do we see on TV with prominent business people? What do we see? I've had this with friends. What do we see happen a lot? We see people get a job and they spend most of their life in a job and... They fuck around. They mix sex,
yes,
with the workplace. So if you subscribe to my MYD program, Manage Your Dick program, here's what I recommend. You know, I was talking to Jeremy before we went on the air. When there's strong feelings and there's strong emotions in a relationship, let's say me and Cory get in an argument, okay? Someone would probably say, guys, if it's an important argument about an important decision, they'd say sleep on it. Right? Mm-hmm. So part of the MYD program is masturbate on it. Because I believe, listen to me right now, I want everyone to test this. And I've spoken to women that will attest to this. There is nothing that will change your brain chemistry faster than rubbing out a fantastic release. And that can go for a man. No, listen, I'm just talking about fantastic. It's raining and everything, and it feels fantastic. But what happens afterwards is your brain clears the fuck up, and those aggressive thoughts you had of either texting a coworker, of either saying something inappropriate to a coworker, or worse, touching somebody or just doing something out of line, they go away because all that stuff inside of you, it's out. And for you women as well, listen, you know, it's okay to just rub it a little bit, let it out, because women do the same thing, man. Women do the same thing. They do the same thing to women, and they do it to men too. So let's think about the greatest empire. Fuck business. The greatest empires of all time. They were taken down by a dude who was not on the MYD program. He could not manage his dick. Think about it. That created wars. That created empires that fell. So if we think about how hard and how much we focus on how to get there, right? How to amass some form of power or some form of resources as a male, how the fuck are we not going to talk about how to protect it? And this is just being real as three men who sit in a place where we have some money and we have some power. Dude, like, it's a lot easier. It's a lot easier. Women throw themselves at you, and you have to be on the MYD program, because if you're not aware, fuck, Cory ain't going to be married for as long as he's going to be married. No. I ain't going to be able to keep pushing forward in business because I'm going to get fucking sued. I'm going to lose my money. Mo is got 100 plus employees, 150, whatever he's got. He's going to lose his spot. He's going to get a suit on him. So we fight so hard to get to where we're at. But dude, when we get there, we got to manage our dick. And in closing, what I want to say is when people go at it and fight hard, dude, it's sleep on it. I want the collective consciousness to grasp, masturbate on it, masturbate on it. And I really believe we can hold our position. We can hold our position and not make the mistakes that you're seeing all over TV, that you're seeing or maybe have seen from your friends or family who have lost jobs because they've said some stupid shit because their dick was hard. This is straight talk, Mo.
No, it's straight talk.
So it's real.
It's real. So first I started to laugh, right? Because
it's true.
Because release is glorious.
Yeah. You're right.
Okay.
And you said raining down.
Yeah. And it's healthy.
Yeah. I just never heard the manage your dick program, right? And so it was funny. And as soon as he started talking, I think he probably hit like 50 brain cells in my head, right?
Of course.
And for many of reason, and if you statistically go through
exactly
the downfall of athletes,
there it is.
That was the first place I went to. A guy would sacrifice so much. A guy would sacrifice his high school years, junior high years, collegiate years.
Amen.
And get to a place of prominence, power, and prosperity, right? And at this point, women are coming into this guy's life, and out of nowhere, his dick not being able to be managed is literally drives everything. And then you have his coaches, you have his
They're all trying to manage his dick.
And they like, yo, slow down. This is real stuff. And they be like, yo, slow down. And it drives them into the nightclub, and it drives them into all this other shit. And literally it comes down to a guy not managing his dick.
Mo, I got to ask you a question. Listen, you were running the ball at the highest level, and I'm sure maybe you had some problems when you were younger managing your dick, Mo. Mo, did you have problems managing your dick?
Listen to me. It was super problems with me managing my dick, right?
Okay.
And so I think one of the hardest adjustments for people.
No pun intended.
One of the hardest adjustments is having no fame and then having a lot of fame and having access maybe to a couple pieces of ass and then having access to all the ass you want. That's a problem, right? And I was going to say this, and I'll speak to it more when it comes around. There's something that it was a gentleman who told me. He said, "Man, Maurice," and we had nothing to talk. Our conversation wasn't anything about sex per se. He said, "But there are certain traits," and this was last year. Matter of fact, we were standing inside of a house. We were talking back and forth. He said, "One thing I've known about high achievers," and he said, "This is how you got to watch yourself." He said, "High achievers have high sex drives." And he said, "You have to manage yourself," because he said, "You'll keep on achieving." And he said, the reason that he believes it's like that, he said, because once you figure out how to crack the codes of life, right, making money, doing business, the whole line, he said, you figure out the same thing with women. And he said, women are attracted to powerful people. Women are attracted to people who are prospering. And he said, the same thing that, you know, the laws of nature, he said, people just want to be around and stuff. You know what I'm saying? And true. He didn't say manage your dick. But he needed to. In a nutshell, he said manage your dick.
In a nutshell.
Well, think about this. Think about the size of your brain in your head, right? And then think about the size of the brain that would be in your
alien.
Dick.
No, that would
and
be
that's
your,
the one running most people's lives.
Your
that's
alien
that's
brain.
That's the one I'm going to close it with.
Yeah, listen, listen. What I'll say in closing is we talk about how to manage your money when you finally get it. You know, I'm not used to having money because I came from a place where I didn't have money, and all these proactive steps we need to take to get there. Well, if you get money, like you said, all the fruits of power, access, women, it comes your way. So you got to manage your money and you got to manage your dick. So from that place,
so good, John.
We will bring it down literally. We're gonna bring it down.
You're
okay?
Not going limp though, John.
I'm never limp, dog. Okay, so we're gonna bring it down, and we're gonna go to Cory Gregory time. It's motivation time. Brought to you by the nicest, smiliest man you will ever meet. Get ready for Cory Gregory.
All right, John. Thanks for whispering into my my time period here. So, what I'm going to call my segment today is relevant to what just happened at my house last night, is tattoo motivation. Tattoo motivation. Now, Maurice referenced about going to Disneyland or something about having not tattoos. But
Disneyland.
Like, yeah, no, it was not. Hold on.
You got a Mickey Mouse? You got to tell me about.
When you go to, they got quotes all over the place, right?
Yeah, Disney, yes.
Yeah, Disney, and you, there was someplace else you said that the other day, too. Maybe it was at football or something.
Yes.
And I was thinking to myself as I was driving here, because I had actually other topics I was going to talk about, and I thought the reason why I wanted to get tattoos was to keep myself in check and to be as meaningful as possible. That's why it took me till I was 30 to get my first one. And if I look down, and we can post it on Instagram, the reason why I got the coal miner's crest in the old school, and the reason why it's on this forearm is because for 15-hour shifts, I was on my knees with my back rubbing the ceiling. This right here was the fucking motor, like all day long. Shovel. So if you look at, there's 8 miles of belt line, 600 feet under the ground. And I'm on the right side of the belt line most of the time that I worked there. And that they would just be coal spilled for as long as you could see with your cap light. And that was my job, on my knees with my back rubbing the ceiling. The ceiling's 42 inches high, to just go shovel on the belt, shovel on the belt. So as a blue collar person, your hands and your forearms is where the fucking, that's where it's at. Mm-hmm. And so to me, I never wanted it anywhere else. I wanted it there so I could see it. And so I could remember that right there, that turnover for all those hours, that's where the fucking gear was. And that no matter what happens in my life and how sweet I think I am or want to be or going to be, that right there is the four generations of real hardcore work mentality that I have to keep, no matter what happens. And that's why I wanted it. That is my motivational quote. It's just on my fucking forearm. Mm-hmm. To keep me in check, no matter what the fuck's going down, no matter who I'm hanging out with, no matter how much money I got, what car I drive, it doesn't matter, right?
Place from humility.
Absolutely.
Gotcha.
And in the old school is just how I've always viewed myself. My gym's called Old School Gym, but I've always had a throwback mentality because of the way I grew up. And so that right there, which I got redone up by Jimmy Blue, is cool, and it kind of reset it up and brought it back to life, right? But I started to think about why I wanted it there. And it's because of that was like that extra gear that the family had for all these years.
Let me ask you this, and that's probably for the listener, but what it describe the old school mentality, right? I mean, from knowing you and being around you, I get it.
Yeah.
But to the dude who's just listening,
that's a great question.
You know what I'm saying? Like, what is the old man's?
I think it's
two things. What is it, and then why is it important to you?
Yeah, I think it's a lot of stuff that John speaks to too, which is another reason why I like John so much, is the shake your hand, look you in the eye, you know, put in hard day's work, no matter what that means in your life. I think it's be good to people. I think it's like, be true to yourself. And I think to me, like, I feel, I've always felt kind of like an old soul. Like, things I've been into, things I've been around, like, I don't know. It's just like, it's always felt, that's why sometimes I wonder if you live other times.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Hey.
I've always felt that way about myself, which is kind of crazy. You're going to laugh at this, Mo. You'll like this. I, for some reason, thought I was like an old school jazz player or something from back, like a black jazz player or some shit from back in the day. Like I get like this.
I wouldn't laugh at that.
You know, no. It's just like, but that was just some weird feeling that I've had. It's like this old kind of like smooth throwback type of shit that's like, anyway, so that kind of old school and just the way I operate, because things get so twisted, I try to keep them real basic. So old school to me is the gym, is the mentality, right? And then on this arm, I just got my great-grandfather. So December 5th, 1935, Joseph and Isaiah Boone died in a coal mine explosion in a cave-in when my grandfather was 9 years old. And he was the first generation lifter. It's emotional because it's kind of crazy. First generation lifter and first generation coal miner. Now, he was teaching my grandpa how to lift weights when he was 9. If this dude wouldn't have started it, it would have never made it to me. And so when my grandpa comes in 2 weeks, he's going to get to see this, 92 years old. And I'm going to memorialize him on such a scale that he could never even dream of. Because every day when I look at that, I know what that means. He never got to see past 42 years old. But what I've been able to do with what he started is something that my family will never be able to forget. And when I get up every day, that shit's real. I don't think I can talk anymore, John. Take it away.
Dad, listen, that's beautiful. That's beautiful stuff. I hope every listener, I know they could feel it. I could feel it. And, you know, I think you make a great point about reminding yourself or having tools to remind yourself on a daily basis about where the fuck you come from and who the fuck you are. And I know those are for you. Obviously, I participated yesterday too. And when I went through times in my life when, like, for example, what I got done yesterday was basically it's called Raise Your Fist and Resist. It's a symbol of basically, like, battling to maintain myself, because there's so many forces that try to put you in a box and try to make you something you're not and tell you you should be this. And it's like the resistance I had to put up over the years to keep who I am, because I really believed that I had something, but the forces were so strong. So that's what this is. Yes, I love Rage Against, but it represented that, man. The music was going through my head, and the visual was like, I need to fight to keep who I am. And thank God I did, because I am proud of who I am today. And that's what's represented here. And I know that's what's represented on your arms, and that's why this stuff means stuff, guys. You got to remind yourself where the fuck you came from, because it's so easy to lose it if success comes in the picture or other people. But we all had to fight for who we are today.
Yeah.
And I think
I'll tell you what, man. I said this before we started the show, and I said, man, if you really don't feel something, you probably shouldn't talk about it.
Correct.
You know what I'm saying? And for you can see the emotion get kicked up on you because it's real. You know what I'm saying? But I think that's the greatest service that we can do on this platform, is just to give real shit to people. And I think we talked about, I don't know if it was one episode, two episodes ago, about preserving something, you know, and having the ability to preserve that. Kind of like that speaks more into what you're doing, preserving a legacy or preserving a mentality or something that's like meaningful. And the irony of everything is that I wrote this shit on my way up here, you know, saying doing shit that's meaningful, you know, and sometimes it hits me that let me know that the synergy is right here. Is when you can write about something, you can get somewhere, and then the platform that you're on, you're talking about that or is relevant to what you're talking about. It's not by accident, but it lets me know that, you know, that makes my trip here worth it. That makes the talk worth it. That makes everything kind of worth it, and I personally enjoy the shit, but I definitely feel you, and I felt the emotion from where you was coming from when you was talking about him, because it lets you know that, you know, it's a real thing to you.
Absolutely.
Well, I think all right, I'm feeling better now. All right, time for Maurice's program.
Yeah, drop it.
Do what you say you're gonna do. I get your ass thrown off the fucking ship like a pirate.
It's some kind of program.
Focusing on the next man's program. Talking about, let's go to the back door barbecue. That's not my program
drop.
And then I get you with the horror program.
If you want to be on the right program.
Yeah, so I would call this the serious program today.
Oh. Right?
So
okay.
Out of all things,
you and Johnny both serious today.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah, no, but I think he just kind of set the tone taking this point, because it's serious and it's really hit me in my personal life the other day. And out of all things, my daughter's 12 years old. She's in eighth grade, right? And she wrote me a letter out the blue, literally wrote me a letter. And the letter, to a degree, was like, hey, daddy, you're being mad. You're mad at me, right? Because everything that I think about all day is about business from the time I wake up to the time I go to sleep. And so she had communicated to her mother that she was mad at me, right? And so obviously Ashley, who's my lady, she got mad at me that my daughter felt that I was being mean to her. But she was saying to me that I come off when I say stuff as always serious or always aggressive. And so I don't know that my mentality or my demeanor comes off aggressive to people. So I'm trying to talk to her like, hey, you know, let me talk to you. Let me, you know, what's going on? But to the letter, to the T, in regards to what you were just talking about or saying, she said, I don't need my dad to give me advice as if I'm a business. I need my dad to give me advice and just be a dad. She said, the reason I'm closer to mommy is because she's listening to me. And it ain't too many moments where I feel embarrassed in life. You know what I'm saying? And where it had put me mentally, you know, I thought I came out of a rough period during the summertime when I was going through what I was going through just with business. And then I got there and I was like, okay, you know, motherfucker, you've arrived. You know, you've got out of that space. And then for my daughter to kind of chin check me, like, boom, motherfucker, I need you to be a dad and not make everything about business all the time. So 100% you're correct with that. And then for me, like having that letter, like, and even yesterday when we were doing a deal on a whiteboard, we were saying something and I reached in my wallet and I thought I had it in my wallet because I was going to show it to you all, but it wasn't. But, you know, even for me, you know, having the ability to not look at everything as if it's a business transaction, but then understanding you have to condition your mind to be systematic in business. And then when do I turn it off and when do I turn it back on? And I don't know, you know, I might be just early on in that process. And, you know, maybe you may talk to somebody who's, you know, fucking been in business for 30, 40 years and they can teach you to talk to you how to deal with it. But it's definitely tough. You know what I mean? And really that conversation that I had with my daughter had really put my brain into place. It primed my brain to just be in a serious space for, you know, probably for the last 4 or 5 days. It's not that I'm not serious about life in general, but just had me thinking about things that I probably wasn't normally thinking about. And like everybody else, I found out that John McCain had passed away. You know, he passed on. And so I woke up out the blue. I go run. And as I'm running, I'm thinking to myself, I was like, damn. I say, you know, like, you know, what is it all about? You know, you go out here, you hustle your ass off, you serve your country, and, you know, you do everything that you're supposed to do as a man, and at the end of the day, it's over. You know what I'm saying? And I start playing a movie through my head. I say, you know.
Death has a funny way to make you think like that, don't it?
Yeah,
know?
Bro, it was serious, you know. And so to bridge both conversations together, I was bridging that. You know, my daughter was saying, hey, I need a father, right? And so this was, she wanted a father out of life, right? She doesn't want this businessman, right? And then I'm pushing for business because I think business is important. And I want to make sure that all of these battles that I fought to go uphill, those same troubles don't exist to my daughter, but she'll still have her own troubles no matter how hard I fight to erase the other troubles that she's had, right? Sure. I'm trying to erase poverty troubles, but she'll have other troubles that she's basically developing as a human being. And there'll be certain securities, but they'll still bring troubles as an adult, right? And so when I seen John McCain pass away, I just, you know, it put this thing in my head. I was like, man, you know, what is life really all about? You know, is it a lifetime of serving other people? Is it a lifetime of fulfilling yourself and mastering yourself and just becoming the best person to humanity in general, you know? And it just put my mind in a space where I just couldn't, like, I told you the entire day on the jog, even as I was around there jogging, thinking about my daughter, you know, I'm thinking about things that I had come out of, you know, in childhood, in prison, post-prison, things that didn't have anything to do with money or business. And I was asking myself, you know, like every day that you wake up, you know, aside from business, like, what is your life all about? You know, and what like, what are you really here for?
Those lines get skewed, Mo.
Bro, get skewed. Cause like, bro, like, here we go. I was in the bathroom today. I'm washing my face. I'm brushing my teeth. And after that, I put some lotion on. And literally, I was like, man, I'm grateful to be able to do this. You know, simple shit. Like, simple shit that, you know, we would just probably overlook. But, you know, in a context, I'm thinking about John McCain because, you know, you did. Dude comes off.
He couldn't do that today.
He comes off the cancer treatment. And as simple as it may seem, like, your limbs are healthy, your life is healthy, your body is healthy. Like, none of this shit means nothing else. Like, and just being grateful in a space to say, hey, like, I care about my life and how much we overlook shit. You know, you're talking about relationships, but we're talking about just basically being able to take care of yourself or being able to go downstairs and, yo, the lights work, the heat work, the air works, the car works, you know, just simple shit. And I don't know if it's something else that this the thing that my daughter brought up to me through the letter, to do the to stem to the John McCain. I don't know if it's something else is leading to that may just unravel me as a person, but it was just definitely interesting. And that's kind of like where I'm just, I've been there for like the last 3, 4, 5 days.
I think a big part of it, at least in my opinion, and this is all obviously individually opinion based, is when it's all said and done, what are the things that people are going to continue to feel about you when you're gone and that no one can take away from you? So let's use you as an example. No one can take away what you went through and what you persevered through and how you came out on the other side. That will be a large part of your legacy that if anyone has half a brain, they have to respect. So your story has begun in terms of being written. So I think it's things that cannot be taken away from you. You know what I'm saying? Like, no one can take that away from you. You know, things I've overcome, no one can take that shit away from me. And then it's how we impact people, right? How we take the things that we've gone through and how we share that with people to just make this, you know, John McCain, he was a guy who would go to, he was a Republican. He was a guy who would go to the most liberal Democrat in Senate. And he would, he knew that we need to come, it's country first. He knew he needed to get with the Democrat to make things work. So he was a guy who would put other interests aside for the betterment of the country, because he knew that's what was best for the country. No one can take that away from him. No. That's why they called him the Maverick, because he would go and do what other people wouldn't, and he's going to always be remembered for when Donald Trump was trying to kill this bill, he fucking thumbs down the motherfucker, walked out, and walked into heaven. I mean, that's what John McCain's legacy is a guy who wasn't bought, paid for, and he lived his own life, and no one can take that away from him.
He wasn't scared, bro.
I think that's where I'm at. Like, even to say that, I've always loved people. I've always enjoyed people. I've always enjoyed impacting people. And I guess just like, you know, just like what you lifting weights, right? You start off as a novice, and the more that you invest in it, the more you learn about it, the more passionate you become about it. And then you get things that just drive you, right? And I don't know, I guess this is a long time coming, just like a separation of thing person. You know, yep, what I'm saying? And really, man, and sometimes we say it so lightheartedly, you know, even to when we're talking about going around to universities and talking to kids and things of that nature, like, literally, I'm just at the place in my life, like, if helping motherfuckers is not, like, the main thing in what we're doing, I just don't even want to be involved in it. That's just kind of like where I'm at. You know what I'm saying? Like when you just, you know, when you talk about, and I guess that's how you keep and maintain perspective, even with your own family. You know, if the conversation I'm having with my own family is not about helping or creating a tighter bond from a family perspective, I guess that's how I get there and stay there. But then, or just our lives in general, you know, and I don't know why it takes death to make that come to the frontal part of your existence in your mind. But like just these last few events, I was like, man, it's really important to help motherfuckers. And whether you're helping them to break through to another level, whether you're giving them information, whether you're giving them to opportunity, because everybody on some level is connected to other people,
yes,
who could use their help. And so that's just kind of like where I'm at. You know, you jog around a track, you think you work out. And I was also talking to you about that. Like there's something very healing and very rewarding about working out outside that I didn't have, right? So I don't know, like, even how the fuck I pivoted here, but I think this is a very important just to share to people. For, you know, last 8 weeks, I've been running outside on the track, mm-hmm, and I've naturally felt better. And when it started raining real hard, because we had rain here for like the last 8 days, I ended up buying a membership at Planet Fitness. And I went down there just, you know, it's $10. I go down there, buy a membership, and I can still do cardio, but I can feel the difference being indoors working out in comparison to being outside.
Harmony's not the same, Mo.
Oh, bro, when I ran outside today, I even, like, just the freeness, the not seeing walls, the not seeing people, the not being occupied, it was just, like, very healing to me. And I was like, this is cool. And so as long as I can, I'm going to keep on fucking working out outside.
I love it. I love it. All right. All right, so main event. We're going to talk about pushing away others' thoughts, not letting them rent space in our head and dictate what we do, which it's a huge, massive problem for basically everybody.
I think you will never – actually, I know. You will never know what you want to do in life if you don't silence everyone's opinions of you and what you're doing. If you allow your mother and your brother and all your friends to get in that headspace of yours and you're trying to figure out, what is my path? What do I want to do? If the thoughts of those people or of us on the podcast, if you're us saying certain things, the only time you will ever know what you really want to do in life is when you silence the fucking world out and you feel what's inside of you that you cannot deny. And that involves no other human being. All that is you and that fucking passion inside of your heart. Now, I'll tell you, when I had the fucking idea to retail fucking MMA clothing, which is so basic, back in fucking 2005, okay, when I had that idea, the second I got that idea, I'm telling you right now, if 40 people would have called me over the course of a month, I wouldn't have answered because I was so obsessed. For example, there was this company, right? I thought they were the coolest company at the time. They were called Six Deuce, right? They were based out of Iowa. And I literally thought in my brain, it would be the coolest job in the world if I could sell Six Deuce, if I could introduce Six Deuce to a customer base and introduce Six Deuce to my area, because I had a retail store. And just the thought of it, if 4,000 people told me it was the ugliest shit, it was the stupid, I'd have said, fuck you, motherfuckers, watch me move Six Deuce. And I just take myself back to that feeling, and nobody else told me anything about Six Deuce or any other brands. It was me, and it was this driving, burning thought in me that, like, I could see it. I could see Six Deuce on the fucking shelves in my store. I could see it on my website and how cool my website would look if I got fucking Six Deuce. And then I called the owner of Six Deuce to actually wholesale the product, and he's this dude in Iowa who just is like, yeah, man, you could buy it for, like, I don't know, like a 60% discount. Like, you know, you could spend $100 and I'll get, like, it became so realistic. Yeah. And I only found,
I want to wear it, John. I'm so excited.
Right. And I only found that out because this thought was undeniable.
Yeah, I love it.
And it drove me, and literally that's why I'm sitting here today, because I started with that thought, and oh my God, that thought was burning inside of me, and it had nobody else to do. I remember I had a friend tell me, you're going to go and invest $30,000 in t-shirts. What if you don't sell them? I said, fuck you, bro. Yeah. What if I don't sell them? I said, I'm going to sell the shit out of them, and then I'm going to invest $60,000. Like, I want everybody to understand, for as long as you let people tell you what you should or shouldn't, or give their opinion on what you want, when you know what you want, man, you will never get to where you want to be. And you will always ask yourself, why am I not there? Why am I not there? Because you're letting other fucking people dictate what you're doing. Yeah. That's not you. You know what's burning inside of you. Six Deuce was burning inside of me.
I'm wearing Six
thank
Deuce.
You.
And I'm drinking a Deuce
hey,
Deuce.
Thank
That's
you,
what's
Craig.
About to happen. I'm drinking a Deuce Deuce wearing Six Deuce.
Six Deuce owes us like 10 grand for how many fucking times I dropped that. Okay, on to you.
So good.
It's the truth, though.
I think it's amazing.
It's the fucking truth, man.
I think one kind of thing that comes to mind for me is, like, the same way, like, when I realized personal training was a thing, I just knew, like, that was something I absolutely 1,000% could do. And I thought that was, like, I'm in. I'm going to go figure it out. It's when I moved up here to Columbus to get rolling. So as I started training clients and then opened my little shop, one day I come home. I talked about this once before, but I think we got a lot of new listeners, so I'm going to talk about it. I come home to campus where I was living with all these people, and everybody's sitting around the table like they're about to have an intervention, right? So I roll in. I swear to you. Now I don't really drink that often or use any drugs. So I'm thinking, what the fuck are these dudes doing? They're like, gee, we need you to sit down. I'm like, all right. So I sit down, and they're like, man, you're not really going out with us on Thursdays no more. You're really like busy on this business. We're worried about you. I said, oh, you are. I said, well, go ahead. Let me hear what your worries are. And my first dude, he says, what happens if it doesn't work? They were genuinely concerned because they was so far from what they could grab at that point. I said, look, motherfuckers, I got this. Now, I don't think I know everything how to run a personal training studio, do all this, but like I was pushed into this. It's an opportunity, and I'm gonna kill it because guess what? I got no plan B. That's
pretty
it.
Much.
And the only thing I think about from when I get up to when I go to bed is lifting weights. And when I found out I could help people with that passion for lifting weights and build their confidence and see the way they grow and see the way they interact and be one of the most positive people they might see all day long. I didn't realize that woman that would come to train with me, she might never, her husband might shit on her at night. She might have a shitty boss. She might never talk to anybody that's nice to her.
That's going to encourage her.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And so when I realized I matched those two things up, I literally knew that I was on fucking fire. Just like John talked about, that you couldn't stop me. That's why when the dude said, when I left that first place to open my own joint, he was like, this isn't even going to work. It didn't work for this person. It didn't work for that person. I said, motherfucker, those people ain't me. I'm
pretty
a whole
much.
Different breed.
Yes.
I was in the coal mine shoveling on my knees for 15 hours thinking, get the fuck out of here so I can get this opportunity. And I wasn't about to squander it. And so I said real nice to my friends, like, yo, I understand that y'all don't get it, but just check this out. Just watch it. And I'll be there when I can, but I'm in a different
But you don't
right
even
now.
The beauty is you don't even owe those people an answer, right?
No.
When someone comes at you when you got that fucking burn
yeah,
inside you.
It was funny.
It's like, ah.
Yeah,
go out the door, bro. I got me.
I had a college. Yeah. I had an intervention because I was not taking place in the college atmosphere.
In the system,
ain't that some shit,
brother? But it doesn't surprise me, man. I tell you this: why I love being back here because I was having this conversation the other day with my guy Mike, and I was talking to Mike, and I said, Mike, you know, he's on an entrepreneurial path, and I called him out the blue because I had this burning feeling in me. That I just wanted to encourage him. I call him from a spirit of encouragement. Mm-hmm. And I just was like, my man, you got to be fucking crazy and know you're crazy to follow yourself.
Yeah.
Because at every turn in America is built for people to deny you.
Damn right.
Or
oh,
built
shit.
For
yeah.
people to say that doesn't work or mm-hmm. built to people, right? And there's times when people felt it on the show the other week when I was talking about this was like the Super Bowl moment in my life, right?
Yeah.
And but there's no there's not an abundance of people I can go to BW3 or Applebee's and talk about this and I say, hey, I encourage you, I go, you got it,
right?
But if I wanted to go the other path and do something that I know isn't true to myself or something that I really want to do, there's an abundance of room for that. You know
yeah.
what I'm saying? And understanding that. There's nothing wrong with consciously being stubborn and stubborn enough to see your ideas actualize and see your ideas manifest and knowing that you're working on them and knowing that this shit may not happen overnight, but it's going to happen the longer you pay attention to yourself. And as you all were talking, I drew something in my head. I said, okay, it's very simple. I always think of the most fascinating thing I have is my fascination with a GPS system. And I'm saying, man, this is your fucking mind in your hand. If you want to get somewhere, you put the destination in there, and this thing gives you the exact directions on where you have to go. And I say almost like your self-talk or the thoughts that you place in your head, if you're not taking in information or things from other people that encourage you to get to that destination, or you're not saying how you can get there or planning on how to get there, you'll never get there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And if I listen to John and John just shitting on me all day, John does nothing but takes my focus off of my path, off of my GPS journey.
Can I run a practice on you?
What's up?
And this is me playing devil's advocate, right? Just for the listener.
Mm-hmm.
So Mo, you got out of prison, you're a felon.
Mm-hmm.
You fucked up on the national scene. How the fuck are you going to open a treatment facility? How are you going to do it, man?
How am I going to do it? I'm going to do it. I've studied it. I know what's going on.
Why should anybody trust you?
Why should anybody trust me? Because I know what's going on. You know, I know why I want to do it. I know why.
You just got out of prison. How do you know how to start a business?
I researched and I read. I've learned from some guys that I would like to believe are respectable. I understand in my heart, you know, why I want to help people.
But you have this reputation. Why would anyone walk through your door?
Because they love me. They love me and they believe me.
See, that's my point. Yes. It's you probably heard all those things in every different way from every different fucking angle, but it's the unwillingness to give to it and be like, you know what? You're right. Maybe that is a problem.
But you want me to tell you one thing? Yeah. You want me to say another thing? Those thoughts, and I don't want to act to the listener as if like I'm Superman. Those are thoughts that I have about myself at times.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying? So the enemy isn't just always outside. The enemy is inside of yourself.
For sure.
Right? And getting up and listening to things.
Most people's enemy is
themselves.
Because you, but in all fairness, because you're developed, you've learned to silence the others. So yes. now the next enemy is the ego.
Yes.
And that's probably what.
Yeah. So it's, even when you were having that, I was trying to put my mind in a place to where I'm not where I'm at right now. It's easy for me to say fuck you because
exactly.
Like, you know, so it's, but
which is what your natural reaction would have been, where how you sit right this
but
second.
But then the more successes you have, the more confidence you have, and say man, get the fuck out of here.
I know exactly.
You know what I'm saying? But giving you a chance to have one victory, then that victory builds on the next victory, and then you get confidence for doing business. But in my mind, I know, and this is directly to the listener, I know how easy it is to impose doubtful thoughts on yourself. And really that conversation between you have with this natural lower level of consciousness and doubting yourself, and understanding the behavior that comes from doubting yourself, that is the thing that you have to overstep and overcome before you get introduced to the world. Because I don't give a fuck if you Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, nobody wakes up and just has supreme confidence at the top of the day every day. You have to do shit, and then you have to maintain it, and you have to keep going. And we may see Jeff Bezos' snapshot of, you know, $200 billion, but he may have felt great on that day. But then, you know, March 7th, fucking 2019, he may have a shitty day with something, you know, and it knocks his confidence off. You know, you got Superman just because you got a bunch of fucking money. No. You know what I'm saying? That just, you know, you have it, but there's still shit you have to work on. And I bet you he's still trying to evolve, just like as Apple still trying to evolve, fucking GE, max effort, everybody's still trying to do it.
Absolutely.
But what does it always come down to? That fucking daily self-talk.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And do I have it? Can I do it? And then once you get over that hurdle, then it comes to the world, but you have to take care of yourself enough and prepare yourself enough and armor yourself enough with the fucking, like, mental relentlessness. You know what I'm saying?
Well, here's the other thing is the thoughts that are usually being imposed on you by whoever these people are that in the situation we're talking about is, like, I always think to myself, the person that's trying to impose this thought on me, what was their level of success or their outcome to this thinking?
You know, but they don't, like, even matter, right?
But because they don't. But what I'm saying, I agreed. But when you're young, and let's just use somebody's dad for example. Okay. Somebody's dad saying that's, well, I had this exact example. There's a kid locally that's a trainer, and his dad said that's a hobby. Like, how do you think that you can make, like, you know what I mean?
No.
And so he was starting to internalize that, and then he came and asked me at the Business and Biceps Live. This is what my dad said to me.
Well, that's fucking stupid because anyone could look up fucking personal training and find out that it's a big industry. I mean, his dad's retarded.
But either way, what I'm saying is this scenario happens a lot, I think.
No.
So you got to look at who's, even though it's your dad and you respect him, you're like, but dad, you got to look at, like, your dad doesn't, this person doesn't know better than you know, probably.
Here we go, Corey, but even when you talk about from a psychological standpoint, people project, right?
Yeah.
I'm telling you like this. Mm-hmm. Anytime that I've done, and I'm not talking about the woman that I have now, right? I would be in high school. I would be in college. Anytime that I was messing around with other girls, I would always project those thoughts on her. Like, oh, shit, I'm a sneaky guy, you know, so I have to be, she has to be sneaking around too.
Right. Yeah,
right?
Yeah, I got you.
But that works for the same thing with people when they're projecting their failures, right?
Hey, that's
so
what
if
I'm getting
I was
at.
Pursuing,
yeah.
That's what I was talking about. So yep. If I was pursuing this, I wouldn't make it.
Right.
So let me tell John, let me tell Corey, I don't think you'll make it because of all of these fucking what is that called? Being a pessimistic?
Yeah, pessimistic. Yeah, yeah. Not
you can never search in somebody's head and understand what they're willing to sacrifice for success or for accomplishment.
Well, and what I think, what I was trying to run through with Maurice is, yeah, not only other people, but the thoughts in our own head. So if I turn around on myself, John, why the fuck could you contribute to a supplement company? Why should you be an owner of it? What the fuck do you know about supplements? What have you done in fucking... You know, these are all things that never stop, right? These thoughts are in everyone's head. It's not like they go away. It's that you learn to manage them,
yes,
and combat them and put them in a compartment, because it's not going to be a magical day where it stops. But for the listener who's hearing all these things either in their head or from other people, learn to manage it and listen to yourself. Because I could answer every question I just threw out there, just like you answered every question. I was trying to be your subconscious. It's all about managing it personally. Yeah.
You know what? You know what I relate it to, right? So if me and you got up right now, and we went to the gym, and we went to go hit the heavy bag, right? Our first two or three rounds of hitting the heavy bag, we would be warming up and getting lathered up, right? We wouldn't be as loose and explosive and everything else, right? But after about like fucking five or six rounds, and we would say, hey, let's turn over some combinations, we would be smacking the shit out of the bag, right? But I think your thoughts like that are the same way, because I can literally monitor my thoughts when I'm running the track, right? And when I'm warming up and just getting to the track and I'm starting to think, like literally, if you catch me at the top of the morning, it's like negative. You know what I'm saying? And thinking about what I'm doing. But the more times I get around the track and the more I'm encouraging myself to get around the track. And then also I'm monitoring myself. What like when I go to the track, what exercise am I trying to avoid? Right. So I hate fucking sprints. Anything over 100 meters, I fucking hate. So I said, fuck this. I'm doing 200s. Right. I'm cranking out 200 because that's what I'm trying to avoid. Right. And so I'm putting in my head, but once I get warmed up mentally and physically, I'm happy I did this shit. Yeah. But I think life is a lot like that, and combating those thoughts or combating those people.
Absolutely.
But once you warm yourself up mentally, and then once you get out, like warm yourself up with a bunch of a shit ton of positive self-talk. So by the time I get to John, man, motherfucker, I've already revved this engine up, baby.
Yeah.
Fuck you and how you feel about me. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And literally, that's what
it sharpens you ready for those situations to handle them right. The good
absolutely,
or the bad situations.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. And that's when, man, dude, that's when you can tell the world you a bad motherfucker, because I've conquered myself.
Right.
That's the first animal to conquer every fucking day. I've conquered myself. I've got myself together, and I'm going to keep myself together. And I think that's like the master. I think that at the end of the day, man.
Run towards the fire, man.
Run towards the motherfucking fire.
That's it. And when you hear John, a.k.a. yourself conscious, when you're in that zone of running towards the fire, you know what to do, right? Put your fucking head down, lower your shoulder, maybe a stiff arm, and John goes fucking flying.
I guess the systemic thing is like, is that where all growth like sits at?
Absolutely, yes. Like, running into the fire.
Yeah, as you sit here talking about it, I'm thinking about just so many ways that parallels in life, the things that you don't want to do, the things that make you
it's uncomfortable.
Like,
from chaos comes clarity.
Man, that's it, man. That's it in life. You know, the things that you just want to fucking avoid to go feel good.
Right.
The things that you want to avoid is ultimately where the fuck you grow at.
A lot of guys say when they put lists together, they always put the top three things are the things they're trying to avoid first. The procrastination, the paperwork, the shit they don't want to do. They usually put those at the top of the list. That's a good way to knock them out.
Put those at the top of the list.
Instead of at the bottom of the list, because you're like, oh yeah, I'm cool on this, I'm cool on that. And oh yeah, if I got some time, I'll get to those two, three things. Like paperwork for me is always brutal. Anything has to do with taxes.
Man,
you know what I'm saying? But if you put that shit at the top of the list, and you're like, it forces you to go at it first, I think that helps a lot.
I'm going
to
tell you this, Corey. You're telling the fucking truth. I'm going to tell you this. You're telling the truth. And from doing something as a company over the last week, and I was on the back porch going through paperwork, right? Going through every fucking number. And you're talking about every number.
I saw it on Instagram.
I'm going through utilization. I'm going through revenue. I'm going through taxes. I'm going through employee calls. I'm going through every fucking thing, insurance, everything. We literally if we go and do the same thing we did next year, we figured out a formula to save 250.
Yeah.
From going through things that you just going through things that you try to avoid, that you don't normally want to go into, you don't normally want to do. And my man, I have been up since fucking 4:30 in the morning, and now I'm starting I'm starting an important and daunting task at fucking 8 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
Right. And I was sitting there and I was like, man, this is the shit people don't want to do. But I could be down the street at fucking BJ's Bar and Grill. Homie. Brother, listen
to me. You could be on the barbecue program.
Hey, Ted's Buffalo Burger Program.
Yeah, I'll tell you like this. BJ,
instead, you were on, I'm about to buy Ted's Barbecue fucking program.
Well, I'll tell you like this. I don't want to give him a plug until they give a check. like this. There's a place I just found recently, and I fell in love with their salads.
Okay.
And I'm talking about like, we're talking about like the most fucking flavorful salads.
Where's it at, Mo?
Mo, just drop it.
No.
He said no. Hit him with the sponsorship, Mo.
Hit him with the sponsor. So if you're in Columbus and you want a good salad.
DM Maurice. Maurice.
Yeah. So they have two things.
He's going to get DMs for salads. Yeah. Here we go. Guaranteed.
They have one. So they have a fucking, what is it called? What's the fucking joint called? They have the salad, and they got these things called Pazookies, man. And it's at BJ's. So they have these fucking cookies in a fucking pan.
Oh, cookies in a pan with vanilla ice cream on top?
Yeah.
Forget about it.
Hey, dude.
Forget about it. Look.
Hey, Haven came over.
Hey, that's over.
So it's like in his little small cast.
That's not Corey G's program right
It's
now.
Over.
Hey.
That's the best shit ever, dude.
I'm in the Get Ripped program right now.
Dude,
cast iron pan.
Yeah, like your mom would fucking cook back in the day, bring it out. Dude, I'm with you. I want it.
Hey, so that's a horrible combination, a salad and a cookie with ice cream.
Give me the cookie with ice cream. I'll take it all day, brother.
You can't outrun that program, Mo.
Hey. No.
Yeah. You can't outrun that program.
All right. It's brought to you by Robinhood, one of our favorite sponsors here at Business and Biceps, because they have democratized the American financial system, John.
And I think what a lot of people don't know is that the app is free. The education is free. Getting a free share of stock is free.
Nothing in the world's free, but this is.
Right. So literally go to the App Store, download Robinhood, and claim a free share of Apple, Sprint, or Ford by going to
biceps.robinhood.com.
Dude, just download the app. It's simple.
You know, I was even seeing yesterday when I was on the app where it even shows the eyeballs, almost like a Snapchat on how many people are looking at the different articles under the stocks where they give you the information. They're really, the platform is pretty fucking sick.
Can the podcast be stopped?
The podcast can't be stopped!